for the Big Nasty. Yeah, Big Nasty. Hall of Fame Tampa Bay Buccaneer fan, baby. 10 and Fire Podcast, brother. If you ain't watching, you ain't listening, and you're missing out. Woo!
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to a brand new episode of the Cannon Fire Podcast here on YouTube and iTunes. It's been a little while, been about a week and a half, coming up on 2 weeks. Kind of a slow start to the new year, but you know, the Bucs aren't playing football right now, so what do we really care? But it's good to be back here, guys. I am your host, Red. Evan is not going to be able to be here today, but I do have a very special guest, a pretty close buddy of mine. Pretty cool guy. Not the coolest because he is a fan of the Raiders, but one of the coolest Raider fans you will ever meet, and that is Captain Jack Rackham. Welcome to the show, Captain Jack. How you doing today, my man?
Yeah! How you doing there, shipmate?
Doing pretty good, my man. Glad to hear that you're doing well. And guys, a little quick backstory on Captain Jack. You know, the Bucs do have Big Nasty. Captain Jack, one of the super fans over there in Oakland. Hell of a guy, but I met Captain Jack. I was strolling through the mall one day, the local mall down here in Tampa. Strolling around, just kind of looking around, seeing who's who, seeing what's what. It had been the first time I'd been to the mall in a while. I stumble upon this store called Pro Image Sports, walk in the door, and there's this grumpy old man in a Raiders shirt. Looked right at him and started shooting the shit. We've been friends ever since. One of the coolest guys I know, Captain Jack. Pleasure to have you on the show, man.
Hey, thanks again there, partner. It's, I definitely can't do my hard, salty pirate voice for an entire broadcast. I only do it in fits and spurts. So you get the normal voice here, and I'll try not to be coughing at you because, unfortunately, I've had some bad cough spells recently. So if I do, I apologize immediately right away.
There is a bug going around totally throughout Tampa. You know, I've had a lot of my coworkers come down with colds. I was feeling something a week ago. I'm pretty sure my younger sister has something going on now. So I'm not sure what it is, but there is something going around, and everybody should, you know, be careful in that aspect. But that's not what we're here to talk about today. Today we're here to talk about some football. But really quick, you know, let's dive into Captain Jack. Let's talk about, you know, let's let Captain Jack introduce himself to you guys, because he's going to know more about himself than I ever will. You know, tell us about it, Jack. How did you become a Raiders fan, and just kind of how did it grow into what it is now?
Okay, well, those are very good questions. Actually, a lot of people are unique in the fact that they think that I'm actually from California, and I'm not. I'm from Philadelphia, and I was a Raider fan from the start of basically looking and for professional sports as a young age. In 1972, I was 7 years old, and that's about when you get your big dose of sports as a kid, for the most part, for most people. Living in Philadelphia, you get to have a love for most of the Philly sports teams, so I'm a big Flyers fan, big Phillies fan, but I tell you, my love for the Raiders, and I am a Raiders fan above all else. My love for the Raiders came from going to school with Kenny Blanda. Kenny is the nephew, or great-nephew, I'm not sure which, of George Blanda, the Hall of Famer that played for the Chicago Bears and the Houston Oilers, and then he went to the Raiders. And George Blanda is actually the oldest person to ever play in the NFL. He was a kicker slash quarterback for the Raiders at the age of 48. So getting a chance to hang out with Kenny, and he says, hey, my uncle plays for the Raiders. And, you know, I checked out the Raider games. The Raiders were normally the 4 o'clock game on NBC back in the 70s. And I grew to love the logo. I grew to love a team that basically kicked everybody's butt and took names. And, you know, when you fall in love with a team that just, you know, gets your whole spirit of what you're looking for, it's a lifetime passion. And I've been a Raiders fan for close to 50 years or so.
So you grew up in Philly, and you know, you were surrounded by Philly fans, and he is a salty pirate, but I don't know, you think you just you couldn't handle the abrasiveness that Philly fans were giving out? Because, I mean, we've seen what's going on with the playoffs, chugging beer at the Vikings buses. I mean, Philly fans are out of control. I can't see you in that group.
Yeah, well, and see, there's a big reason why, and that is that my father was in the Navy. So in 1974, we moved to Florida. And being a service brat, you know, I kept my allegiances to all of the teams that I had. So I remained a Phillies Flyers fan, but I remained a Raiders fan in Florida. And actually being in Florida, living, growing up in Orlando, where most of the fans were Dolphin fans at the time. And of course, being a Raiders fan, I couldn't stand the Dolphins. I couldn't stand the Steelers. So I always kept my allegiance there. And so I never, ever got rid of my love for the Raiders. I mean, the Buccaneers came around in 76, but I would never, never trade in the love for my team. And since I got you on here, and I know I got a lot of Bucs fans here, but, you know, I usually call Tampa Bay the faux Pirates of the NFL. I really didn't have an issue with the Bucs as a whole until they changed their logo to crossed swords. And at that very time, I just said, nope, I cannot stand the Buccaneers. It had nothing to do with the Super Bowl.
So you're one of the people who believes that Bucko Bruce was the answer, the original, you know, the winking pirate with the dagger in his mouth.
Well, I'm just saying is that I had no issue with the logo. The reason why the Buccaneers butched up their logo was because a lot of people were making fun of their logo. Oh. What I'm saying is that the Buccaneers took that as a slight to them, and so they wanted to spruce up their logo. And when they spruced up their logo, they wanted to go for something that was more threatening. And what they came out with was a logo that I just despise, in the fact that it has cross swords. The Raiders have had a cross sword logo since 1960 when we came out with the Raider logo.
I got you. I know where you're coming from, and it's definitely a case to be made. I feel you 100% on there, because I definitely feel the same way. You know, if another team turned around and, say, 30 years from now had another logo of a flag as their logo, it kind of, I know where you're coming from. I totally get it. Here's my end of the bargain. And I know you said it has nothing to do with the Super Bowl, but I'm going to make it about the Super Bowl, because I know, you know, it's easy for me to bust your chops, and I'm sure it's easy for you to bust my chops for about a lot of things. Not both of our teams didn't do too well this season. have to be upfront about that. So we are in the kind of the same ship, but until the Raiders beat us in the Super Bowl, we are the Pirates of the NFL for now.
Negative. Negative.
We are going to save that discussion for another time. Let's jump into what we came here to talk about, and that is...
I'm going to just say this real quick. 3 is greater than 1, shipmate.
I can't argue with that, but 2003 was a lot more... You know what? Never mind. Let's talk about the Gruden situation. All right,
we'll
came in.
We'll spar. I got my saber ready.
Oh man, we came in here to talk about the Gruden situation, and I know I told you guys a couple episodes ago that we weren't going to talk about it, but you know, right now we're given a perfect opportunity. We have an Oakland fan, one of the biggest Oakland fans you're ever going to meet. He's going to give us the ins and out of how he feels and how the majority of Oakland fans feel about John Gruden coming in and taking Jack Del Rio's spot as the head coach for the future. Now, we've pretty much laid it all out on the line here on the show the past couple of episodes. We've been following the John Gruden rumors, and then we followed John Gruden going back to the Raiders. And the thing that hurts the most, man, the thing that kills me, is that if John Gruden wins another Super Bowl with the Raiders, the Bucs are no longer his team.
Well, I'm going to tell you this before we got into this. When John Gruden was here in Tampa, and he was a coach for the Bucs, I have it on very good authority, and this is not a lie, this is the absolute truth. I had a air conditioning repairman that went over to John Gruden's house to do repair work on his air conditioner. And I can tell you wholeheartedly that John Gruden was wearing a black and silver Raider shirt when he was met the guy at the door frame. He was coaching in Tampa. The love for the Raiders has always been there with Gruden.
Oh, and that's, you know, that's well deserved. The Raiders were the first team to really give him a shot. He took him as far as he could. You know, how long ago was it now? Was it 16 years ago, 15 years ago, the Tuck Rule scenario? We're not going to. 16 years as of, I believe, a couple weeks ago, or maybe
actually, not even a week. It's been less than a week. It's been about 5 days.
I'm sorry to salt the wound here, buddy. It was a fumble. I agree with you wholeheartedly that Tom Brady did fumble that football. To this day,
it was a fumble.
It was a fumble. But, you know, John Gruden came in, took the Raiders organization, took them to the championship game, very well won them that championship game as it was stolen away, came down here with the Bucs, did the very same thing next year, but won the Super Bowl. The Raiders were always the first team to really open their arms to John Gruden and give him that shot, so I can totally see the love, but the story you just told me about the Gruden polo, that kills me.
It's true, and it's like I had to, because why is this guy going to tell me something like that unless didn't happen?
You don't really, it's hard to make something like that up.
Exactly.
Especially if you are firsthand there, you know, you're going out there for your job. It's not like you ran into him at a bar, and, because I can walk into anywhere and say, yeah, I ran into John Gruden at the bar, and he says he's coming back to Tampa next year. That's anything you can make up. But if you have, you know, a solid foundation of evidence like that story there, totally. That's why it's so hard to swallow. Because the impression down here, especially as the rumors were starting to heat up coming around October, November, the Bucs were losing. Gruden was slowly but surely creeping his way into that picture. And the Glazers did attempt to make something happen. Didn't end up happening. He went to Oakland. But the idea we all had down here was, oh, well, he loves Tampa. You know, this is his team. This is his city. His wife's here. His kid's growing up here. He loves it. He's not going to move. 10 years and a trip to Oakland, $100 million, man. He'll take off, but I'm not saying he's a sellout by any means. Again, the Raiders are probably the only other choice he would have had, if we got to be realistic here. Things didn't work with the Bucs. The Raiders were there with open arms again, and they made something happen. We didn't make something happen. And that's, on a side note, that's where I can respect the Raiders and the organization as a whole. That's why the Raiders are definitely, you know, one of my top AFC teams to root for. Because they are committed to winning. I gotta say, the Bucs could have made a move on Gruden, didn't make a move on Gruden, which shows that they are not 100% committed to winning. So good on you guys for picking up Gruden, but how are you feeling? You know, the pros and cons, because I've seen you voice your opinion plenty of times on this hiring Gruden coming into a long-term deal. It's going to be a long 10 years if it is 10 years, but how are you feeling, man?
Well, and I'm glad you had a chance to remember. The key words are commitment to excellence, stated by the godfather, the boss, Al Davis. Commitment to excellence is everything. And Mark Davis said it best in his press conference announcing Gruden at the hiring, that John Gruden has always been his choice to lead the team. He was very close with Gruden when Gruden was coach out there. And for Mark Davis, there was no other choice. And for those that were, and it's really, it's kind of like a sidelight, for those that are cracking on the Raiders for not following the Rooney Rule, which in itself is hypocrisy, because Al Davis hired the first black coach in the modern NFL. He hired the first Latino coach in the modern NFL. He hired the first woman CEO in the modern NFL, and for somebody to say that the Raiders didn't follow the Rooney Rule, they can just kiss my tuchus. Okay, there's been no other organization that has been more forthright and forward in equal opportunity than the Raiders. In fact, with Al Davis drafting a quarterback in the 68. I believe this guy's name was Eldridge Dickey. And in the second round, he comes and gets Kenny Stabler in the second round. The point is that as Al Davis has always been positive about equal opportunity and equal rights. So people that said that the Raiders, excuse me, didn't follow the Rooney Rule, again, I can show you a picture of my nice, not quite white butt, but you can kiss it all day. Now, getting back to point on the hiring. For those that know me and that have listened to my, webcasts with other folks.
Speaking of which, really quick, if you want to tell the people where they can find you, the name of your show, all that info, this is totally your chance to plug it here.
Well, I can't really plug my own right now because it doesn't really exist. I do plan on getting a podcast of my own upcoming, so look for it. It will probably be on Blog Talk Radio. It'll be Captain Jack's Raider Galleon. That will be the that will be my podcast over on Blog Talk Radio, upcoming after the Super Bowl. So you'll see me there also. Be sure to catch me on Facebook at J Captain Jack Rackham. And Rackham is spelled R-A-C-K apostrophe E-M. So, yeah, please. I enjoy talking sports just like you. So if there's any opportunity to just talk sports, I'll be more than happy to be on with you and you on with me. So we're gonna have some fun talking sports, that's for sure.
Oh, yeah, going to make some noise for sure over the next year, man. Should be a good one.
Definitely so. Now, I'm sorry, the old salty pirate forgot what he was talking about. What was the last comment?
We were on the pros and cons of the Gruden hire.
Ah, there we go. Thank you. For those that have seen me espouse before, I wasn't a big proponent of Gruden being hired. Now, I love John Gruden. In fact, if you go to my Facebook page right now, it's a picture of myself and John Gruden together when John Gruden made an appearance here at the U.S. Central Command, where I have a chance to work. And I can tell you that when he saw me in all my Raider gear, and granted, it wasn't all the Captain Jack gear, but it was a Raidered out Captain Jack that got a chance to talk with him. And you know, you could see it in his face, the sheer, I don't know if it was joy or happiness or just, he just loves the silver and black. So you can tell that he was looking to come back. When I heard him in that leadership conference back in the preseason, it would have been like August or September, and I wrote an article about it when I was writing for Raider Nation Times. It was called, you know, John Gruden is back. And I asked him personally, and other people asked him personally, if he ever had the inkling to come back. And he basically stated in no uncertain terms that he does all of the actions and all of the study and all of the film breakdown and all the things that he needed to do that he does for his quarterback camp and for the Fired Football Coaches of America. He's been coaching without a team for at least the last 10, 15 years, okay? And well, okay, minus whenever he lost the Bucs. So since he's been a non-Bucs coach, he's been coaching without a team.
And you know, something really quick just to point out, it was the point that we had made on the show while people were against Gruden, and people have their opinions, everyone has a right to their opinion, but when you look at John Gruden from a coaching perspective, the argument was, well, the game has evolved, John Gruden's not going to be able to jump back in here and coach the same team that he was able to coach 10 years ago. But when you hear that John Gruden wakes up every morning at 5 in the morning, watches film with his morning coffee, goes and does his daily work, and then goes home and watches film just to swallow that up and watch more film, the guy is serious about what he does. And an excellent point that you made, you know, he was coaching without a team for 10 years. So he has definitely had his hand, at least in being able to watch how the game has evolved between when the Bucs let him go to when the Raiders hired him just a couple of weeks ago. And that's what we're here talking about now. But a great point, man.
And actually, in the fact that, well, John wakes up at 3:17, by the way.
3:17.
Unless he's changed that, it was 3:17 every morning. And he was usually in the Raiders headquarters facility by sometime after 4. So, yeah, Gruden gets up early. He breaks down the films, you know. So he's been there. Now, here's another thing. And again, I was not a proponent for John Gruden. And not because of saying that the game has passed him by, because that's ridiculous. The game has not passed him by. Gruden, for the last 10 years, has gotten more insight to the other 31 NFL teams, or actually 32, because he's been doing the games, and he's been doing the layouts, and he's been doing the cut-ups to all of the people that he's had a chance to talk with. He's gained more insight into all the other teams in the NFL. It's like he was a spy, but getting things for free. So he knows what's going on, and he knows how to tweak things in his favor. And that was where I was kind of coming around to, okay, to me, and the reason why I was not a proponent to begin with was Gruden is a very conservative coach. He's always been to a point where he'll get the lead and he'll take the foot off the pedal. And it was frustrating as a Raider fan to see all of these games where we were winning and had the lead, or would come back and have the lead, and John would take the foot off the gas. And, you know, there's a lot of games where the Raiders might have lost in the end because John just did not finish the opponent. It took Bill Callahan with the team that Gruden built to go to a Super Bowl to make that offense what was phenomenal, to have Rich Gannon as an MVP for the NFL, and to go up against the only team that was going to beat the Raiders that year was a Bucs team where Gruden knew all of the insides and outs of the team that he was coaching against, with a defense built by Tony Dungy. I mean, and I've said it.
Yikes. Laying it all out on the table, but you know, it is something you have to look at. Gruden coming back in the NFL, just like you said, he has such a good idea of what's going on, spent so many years in the booth. A bird's eye view. He wasn't even watching the game from the sideline. It was like he was watching the game from the top of the stadium. Like you said, again, he was able to draw everything out, plan everything up, cut everything up, see what was going to happen. So now he has a very good idea of what he's going to be coming into. And that's why I get so frustrated when I think about how the Glazers missed the opportunity. And by missed the opportunity, they didn't take the opportunity. Talking about John being conservative, letting his foot off the pedal, the Glazers are probably some of the most conservative owners I know in football. These guys don't really want to make any moves. I know it hasn't been about the money for a little while. That was more of an issue we had maybe 5-6 years ago. But when you have a guy like that, like John Gruden in particular, someone who has such a good idea of what's going on in the game of football, he's been there before, he's done it before, he's got a Super Bowl on his resume, obviously against the team he coached the year before, like you did bring up, but regardless, a Super Bowl is a Super Bowl, and 2 out of 4 teams in the NFC South have a Super Bowl, and the other 2 were in the playoff picture this year. Didn't make it, still don't have a Super Bowl. It's a big deal, and the Glazers should have jumped on it when they had the chance, because they had the chance and he was ready to come back, and that's what I think that's what pisses us off so much as Bucs fans. You know, I'm not bitter about it, because I am glad that he went to Oakland. I'm a huge John Gruden fan, and like I said before, Raiders are one of my top AFC teams. The other one has to be the Pittsburgh Steelers, just because of my ties to my significant other. I can't exactly, you know, I can't exactly get away from that, or I'll get in trouble. But here we are, John Gruden works for Oakland again, and we're just pissed off about it. What I had heard, and what I guess what I had initially thought was that Gruden wanted partial ownership and the Glazers wouldn't give it to him. I never heard any concrete evidence that that wasn't the truth, but the way things worked out with Oakland, honestly, I think the Glazers just didn't want to give him that long term of a deal. I think they were looking at something about 4 or 5 years. They weren't looking at 10 years, and he was either going to get 10 years or, as he did, go back to Oakland.
Yeah, and I tell you that nobody other than John Gruden, his agent, his lawyer, and his tax guy know what the deal is with that contract. Oh, and add in Mark Davis and the Raider lawyers and all those people. The only people that know what that contract entails are those people. And it's not going to come out. Now, whether Gruden wanted ownership or not, that's debatable. the point is that it would have been looked upon harshly, probably by those in the NFL. And no, there's no saying that maybe when John steps away from being the coach, that he might gain ownership in a handshake deal, but you can't have it as part of your contract, because these days, you know, the way things are looked upon, it's just the whole rigmarole and the legality is such, it just doesn't make sense. John stated himself that was hearsay and BS. Whether it's true or not, it doesn't matter at this point. John got, and again, allegedly, the contract is 10 years, $100 million. Nobody knows what that contract is.
Right.
And nobody knows what the out clauses are on that contract. The point for the Raiders is that John Gruden is the face of that franchise. Mark Davis wanted him to be the coach of that team, because Mark Davis needs to sell tickets to have people sit their fannies in Oakland this year for 18, and wherever they're going to sit, wherever they're going to be playing in 19, because the Raiders do not have a contract to play in Oakland for 2019. And for Mark Davis to have somebody come out to a Raider game, he has to have something to show to the people. John Gruden is loved in Oakland and by the majority of their fans that realize that, hey, he was traded by Al, and I can go into that story as well additionally at a later time. But I believe him when he said that he didn't want to leave. I do believe that.
Right.
The point is that Raider fans love Gruden. I've warmed up to the idea of John being the coach, because the other thing that I said was it's not just Gruden. It's who Gruden brings to the table, because Al Davis historically did not pay a lot of money for his coaches.
But has he brought forth a cabinet that's really – I feel like he's brought forth a solid staff with him, all the hires he's made so far.
Exactly. Yeah, good segue there, shipmate, because I was going to tell you the coaching staff that the Raiders have on hand right now is probably the best coaching staff that I remember in years, okay? Del Rio came in, and again, hats off to Jack for at least spicing up the Raiders in the coach that wanted to be there. But reading all of the reports about the later years, or about this year in particular, about the dissension in the locker room, about how Mike Tice was a divisive force, how Mike Tice got Musgrave fired because he wanted to elevate Downing because he didn't like Musgrave, how Del Rio definitively kept Ken Norton Jr. on for far too long because he didn't want to fire him, how Del Rio, when he got his contract, became a 9-to-5 coach and was lazy as hell. All of these things are coming out later on. So when you hear about such things, you know, see ya, Jack. I mean, it was great while you led the team from 7-9 to 12-4 to 6-10. No, shipmate, you got to go. And we needed a good coach. And we got one with Gruden, because it's not just Gruden. Paul Gunther is going to be an excellent defensive coordinator. Rich Bisacci, who was his special teams coach in Tampa and for the Cowboys, is a great special teams coach. Of course, John Gruden is the de facto OC, but you bring in Greg Olsen, who he works well with and who works well with Carr, because it was Carr's first OC. And I think that Olsen will be a good addition to that staff, just as long as he is a helper, because as an offensive coordinator, Olsen left a lot to be desired. So hopefully between Gruden and Olsen that they can get things, square them away. You look at the rest of that staff with who they're bringing in. Ansley, the defensive backs coach, who had accepted a position to be a head coach in Colorado State and said, no, I'm going to go join the Raiders. You got Lippincott as a linebackers coach. And, of course, you got Tom Cable, who is a stalwart offensive line coach, even though I'm not really enamored with the zone blocking scheme. Cable is a fantastic coach that can teach both zone blocking and power and plug and pull, you know, a bunch of different things in that staff. So you got all of those things together. You got fantastic guys coming in. The Raiders kept two of their younger coaches from Del Rio's staff because they were coaches that were worth a salt on the younger side. And again, everybody else that's come in on this staff is going to elevate that team. The Raiders have finally figured out that not only do you need to pay the players, you need to have a good coaching staff. And that's why I'm thinking with Gruden and that staff, it's going to be a very good year or two or three or ten for as long as he wants to coach for the Raiders.
And, you know, really quick, last thing we'll talk about the Gruden and then we will move on. But back to bringing in that stable of coaches and guys who can come in here and do their jobs and be great coaches to the players who are getting well endorsed for what they're doing. You know, you guys have the talent on the field to back it up. Navarro Bowman came into that linebacker spot, was a force this year. Khalil Mack always doing Khalil Mack things, obviously. You know, the talent on the field to back it up is exactly what you need. And I think looking back at the Bucs season, that's what went wrong for us this year. Beginning of the year, I got to say, because I remember coming in and talking to you about it, beginning of the year, right at the end of the offseason, right around the draft, we just picked up O.J. Howard in the first round, and everybody was like, what the hell? But we picked up O.J. Howard first round, scoped out some really good talent in the later round. Justin Evans came around. Chris Godwin, hell of a player. That guy is going to be something next year. But aside from all that, beginning of the season, Bucs fans looked at the talent we had on the field, and I got to say, you can lie, but I don't think there was a single Bucs fan who was 100% on the coaching staff that we had. Todd Monken not really doing an awful job as offensive coordinator, but he could barely do his job with Dirk Koetter taking all of the play-calling responsibilities, which isn't something that's going to change in 2018, but, you know, it's a year to put up or shut up, so we'll see what happens. Mike Smith, last year, Bucs were... last year, for the stretch of games that the Bucs won, the five in a row that we won two seasons ago, including Kansas City and Arrowhead, which I'm sure was great for you to see, and the Seahawks here, as well as a couple other games as well. The Bucs statistically had the best defense in the NFL under Mike Smith's scheme. This year, that fell apart, as we saw. And again, coaching. That's what it all came down to. We had all the talent in the world coming into the season. DeSean Jackson was a big move. Chris Baker in free agency was also supposed to be a big move, but he's really just been a big waste of time, and I'm pretty sure he robbed us for $33 million in 3 years, but we'll see what happens here. But just got to look ahead and got to be hopeful about it. But talking about Gruden really quick, this is the last thing I'll ask.
Gotcha.
Do you think Mark Davis made the move? Do you think he was sold on John Gruden for so many years because now they can go and get haircuts together?
Ah.
Gotta say, man, we've made so many jokes about the Mark Davis hairstyle. I'm sure you've heard it before. Oh, but it sets itself up so beautifully. I love the picture of that Gruden press conference. There's one particular picture that I had seen. You know, Gruden's on the mic addressing questions, talking about what's going to happen with this Raiders team in the future. And you kind of see Mark Davis off to his side, and he's looking at him like a son watches their dad build something. You know, he just has this look of awe on his face, and I love it. I really do love it. But you know what? I'd rather be in a situation where we have a funny-looking owner who makes great decisions than some guys who focus more on their Manchester United soccer team than their NFL football team. But that's all we got to talk about Gruden today. And guys, that's probably going to be the last we're going to talk about Gruden. This is the final nail in the coffin, and I've got a Raiders fan here to pretty much take the conversation to his show once it gets going. So this is the last you'll hear of Gruden on the Cannon Fire podcast, unless something drastic happens. But
unless something drastic happens and your Buck fans want to talk Gruden, be sure to tune in and hang out with me, and we'll talk Gruden all day long.
Oh, yeah, man. Definitely, guys. Like he said before, Captain Jack Rackham, you can find him on Facebook at @JCaptainJackRackham. He does live streams, Raider live streams, every once in a while. I know he would do a halftime update on the games, do a post game, you know, do a weekly show every once in a while. You'll pop in, talk about what's going on. Really good community to be around, good conversations to be had. I love popping in there every once in a while. But let's focus on the big picture here as we are getting closer, coming off the heels of an NFC-AFC championship weekend that was really not what I was expecting. I knew the game between the Jags and the Patriots was going to be pretty solid, but let's talk about this Eagles-Vikings game, 38-7. I mean, the Eagles really put the whooping on Minnesota, and do you think it's because they disrespected the Rocky statue? Is that what happened since, you know, the Vikings fans came in and vandalized the Rocky statue and some other things going around? That's where the no mercy rule came from?
Yeah, I tell you, I don't think that was anything that had to do with it. If they actually, it's the first time hearing about it, because again, I kind of tune out if it's very little, that if it's not Raider news or directs me in that respect. You know, I hear things, but you know, I tell you, if they went up and they disrespected the Rocky statue, then you know you're going to piss off.
They dressed it up in on Vikings gear.
Yeah, that definitely will not play well in Philly or Camden, Jersey, Trenton, the entire area there, because it's just going to, you know, that's the fan base. You're going to piss off the fan base. Like I said, I'm a Philly boy, and I know, and we discussed this offline, that Philadelphia is the only place that Captain Jack will not wear his gear.
Let's talk about that really quick. Let's jump into depth about that.
Not okay. The main reason is not because I'm afraid of Philly fans. No. I'm not afraid of Philly fans, because Raider fans roll in droves as well. We have our posse together. I have no problem going into Philadelphia with my buddies of groups of Raider fans. But I'm telling you, Philadelphia fans as a whole are known to be the biggest a-holes. And again, I'm trying to keep my tongue for FCC regulations here. They can be the worst group of fans that you'd ever want to go to a game. They throw things. They throw the beer. They throw batteries. They throw snowballs. They throw everything. And they will do everything they can to just make your entire experience unpleasant. Now, I'm going to quantify this, that say, not all Philadelphia fans are the same, okay? So just because you see all of this on video, okay, does not make the entire whole that whole. But
I know a
large majority of them are going to be a-holes. I'm going to tell you that, because I lived in Philly as a kid, like I said. So I won't go to any Philly games dressed as Captain Jack, because I got too much money, time invested in my gear, my uniform as a Raider captain. I got too much money invested in this to let some a-holes get it all soused up with nasty beer and eggs and all sorts of crap that I'm not going to, you know, be able to take out in the cleaners. I wouldn't give them the time of day. And besides, in Philly, if I'm going to go to a game in Philly, I'm going to go see the Flyers or the Phillies play. I ain't going to go watch an Eagles game.
Now, really quick about the Eagles fans, and you know, they bring those things into the stadium, as you said before, the batteries, the eggs, the warm beer that they serve up there. How do they get a lot of that stuff into the stadium?
I don't know. I mean, people have been sneaking things into the stadium forever.
You ever heard of keistering?
Heard of what?
Keistering?
I can figure out what that is. So. And guess those wands aren't working from that the security guys have up front, which is considering that the TSA should have issues with that, or people that are doing, shall we say, anti-terrorist activities. That's frightening. Just stay out of Philly, guys. Just stay out of Philly.
It's a war zone up there right now. One last thing we'll say about Philly before we move on to the Super Bowl. There have also been some videos going around. I know you said you try to tune out of that stuff as long as it isn't Raiders, and I'm on the same ship with you. I barely watched any playoff games. The only one that I really sat down and watched was the Jacksonville-Buffalo game, the 15-10 shootout of the two mediocre quarterbacks. But there's a lot of videos after the Phillies, after the Eagles win over the Vikings. Have you seen them, man? People are riding on cars. People are getting hit by subway trains, running through the streets. It's a scene.
It's like I said, folks, if you're going to go to Philadelphia.
And these guys didn't even win the Super Bowl.
Yeah, well, but again, it's the closest that they've gotten to the Super Bowl now that they are actually in it in years. Remember, Philadelphia has been to two Super Bowls, of which they've lost both times. They lost to the Raiders in Super Bowl 15, 27-10, and they lost to the Patriots the last time that they played them. I don't care what the score was, because, again, it's not a Raiders game, but they did lose to the Patriots. So, It's one of those things where Philly fans are just aching for a Super Bowl win, because people say that Philly has never won a championship, and that is not right. Philadelphia, the Eagles were the NFL champions in the days before the Super Bowl. So you youngins out there, there was football before the Super Bowl, okay? The Eagles have a championship. The Lions have a championship. The Bears have a championship. People that you said never had a championship. Oh, I'm sorry. Actually, the Bears do have a Super Bowl win, too, but only
the
one.
The Bears.
The Bears. So these people need to remember that there was football before the Lombardi Trophy. So,
and speaking of the Bears and that Super Bowl title, if you haven't checked it out, actually, on the channel, one of our first videos back when this was called Another Sports Podcast, we did have a roster, we did have a player off of that Bears roster, the 85 Bears, Tyrone Keyes, defensive end. He was able to tell us a lot of fun stories about the Bears during that time, a lot of cool things going on. Hate to plug it, but if you're interested, go check it out, man. It is a pretty cool story to be told. So let's talk about the Super Bowl. We are 2 weeks away. The Patriots are going to be playing the Eagles in Minnesota. The biggest game of the year. Titles on the line. Super Bowl 52. Captain Jack, who you got?
Well, I would say because the Eagles are playing 11 on 20, and you can probably figure out what I'm saying by that, the Patriots have gotten every call their way in almost game that you can shake a stick at. Now, I'm not going to say that the Patriots aren't a talented team. I'm going to say that if you have a talented team and the Zebras look out for you, it's pretty hard when you're playing 11 on 20 to win any football game in the NFL.
Without a doubt.
Now, am I saying that the refs have deliberately clouded a game? I can't say that. But what I can say is that if you look at a lot of that is going on, and yes, I'm going to bring up the Tuck rule, that since then, since the Patriot quote-unquote dynasty was started by the Tuck rule, Brady wouldn't be what he is today if it wasn't for that game, okay? Because then you have the implications of after the Tuck rule, they actually have the videos of them looking at the Steelers and have the video of them videotaping the Rams. Then you go back to, you know, I can't remember which gate it was, with the tape gate or whatever the heck they called it. You know, all of the quote-unquote cheating that the New England franchise has done. They got a well-coached team. But it's easy to do things when you know that you're going to get every frigging call in the book. So I'm going to take, unfortunately, the team I despise. Not that I take them, but if you ask me who I think will win the Super Bowl, it'll be New England. However, having said that, the Eagles have been playing over their heads in a good way of being the disrespected underdogs for all of these weeks. They played two playoff games at home as an underdog. The Philadelphia defense is nothing to sneeze at, particularly on their defensive front. They have eight guys rolling through there where they're basically not just the starters and the backups. They roll their defenders on the line for the pressure that is just it's phenomenal. Okay, their linebackers are decent. Their defensive backs are decent. And to win against the Patriots, you got to put Brady on his ass. You got to pressure him. Tom Brady does not like to play with somebody in his face. He doesn't like to play when somebody has kicked him on his butt. The last two Super Bowls, the Patriots should have lost. If it wasn't for a fluke interception or a, you know, what happened last time with a 28-3. You kidding me? You come back from 25 points? Okay, because the Falcons, I don't say they laid down. They were just stupid in their play calling, okay? So the Patriots their last two Super Bowls should have lost. So, if you put that with the fact that they lost to the Giants the one before that, the Patriots are susceptible to a game. Unfortunately, they got 5 wins. They also have a lot of defeats.
Yeah.
The point being is that if you're doing things such as putting money on games, and again, I do not espouse gambling. I do not gamble because I don't have enough money on purpose to be giving it away if I lose, okay? Depending upon what the spread is, and again, I don't care. I don't know because, again, I don't gamble. But most people are going to pick the Patriots because of those intangibles. But I tell you, if anybody can beat those damn Cheatriots, the Eagles are a very capable team to do it because Peterson is a fantastic offensive guy. It took Peterson to take this team to the bounds that Andy Reid could not do. And that's why Andy Reid got his butt kicked to Kansas City, because the Eagles were a perennial playoff team, but they couldn't do anything. And Peterson is a fantastic coach. They have what people are calling a backup quarterback, but you got to remember that Nick Foles holds the record for most touchdowns in a game. I know, because he threw them against the Raiders, 7 touchdowns. Nick Foles is a very capable quarterback that would be a starting quarterback on most teams. He has gotten in sync with his offense. He's got a fantastic tight end in Zach Ertz. Their running game is phenomenal with Jay Ajayi and Blunt as the other plugger. The offensive line has come through when Peters went down, their stalwart left tackle. Everybody is playing well. So if anybody can beat those damn Cheatriots, the Eagles can. Yes.
Now, back to what you had said about, you know, the key to beating the Patriots is stopping Brady. Going back to our week, whatever it was, matchup, it was the Color Rush Thursday night game. I was out at Wing House, actually, watching that game. The Bucs played the Patriots Thursday night football. We sacked Tom Brady 3 times and won that football game. Nick Folk lost the football game. Obviously, if we would have made one of the 3 kicks that he missed, we would have won the game. But Bucs were the better team that night. And I'm not saying that to toot our own horn, but I'm saying, if you can get to Tom Brady, you can win the football game. And taking a look at the Bucs' pass rush this year, the fact that we were able to get to Tom Brady 3 times is a miracle. So like you said, if anyone can do it, it's the Eagles. I'm not putting money on it. Don't have any desire to put any money on it. The rest of my family is actually from Boston. My stepdad and all of that side, my grandparents who live up in Jacksonville, all of them are from Maine and Boston area. So that's all I hear about in this house is how the Patriots are going to take it home again. And I want to believe that the Eagles can do it. I would like to see the Eagles win. As much as their fans or a majority of their fans get a bad rap, I've always liked the Eagles and I like to see them do well. They're one of those teams that you don't want to count out. And like you said, man, that front line that they have, Chris Long in particular, these guys are out here making moves and doing whatever they can to get to the quarterback. They are a very capable defense that nobody should turn a blind eye to. The way Jacksonville held Tom Brady to the game he had, I think it can happen. I think it can happen. If I'm going to put my chips on one side of the table, I'm going to pick the Eagles. I'd like to pick the Eagles. I want to mix it up. I want to see something different. So I could be wrong. I don't care. It's going to be a good game. A lot of people think it's going to be a slaughter, but it's not. People hate the Patriots, but the only thing I can say is that all the past Super Bowls they've played in have been fairly entertaining, have they not?
Yeah, I would say that if you're looking for a good time and from Boston, then yeah, go ahead and watch a Super Bowl. But I seem to recall when the Patriots were the laughing stock in the NFL. But then again, I'm an old man.
Oh, I've heard stories from my grandfather as well. He lived through it.
So, you know, it's going to take somebody, and hopefully it's the Eagles, to put Brady on his ass and put Belichick into a box. Not literally, because I would never espouse murder, but when Belichick
finally
leaves this organization, when Brady finally leaves the organization, and as people would have been saying, Belichick did not want to get rid of Garoppolo because Belichick knows that Brady is not one that's going to be lasting too many more years. I can definitely see Brady come back for one more, but I really can't see him beyond 2018. So it all depends upon what happens on this Super Bowl. And it's probably, being a Raider fan and let things come full circle, it'll probably take a hopeful Raider playoff team in 2018 to play the Patriots, hopefully at a home game in Oakland, because God knows I don't want to go out to New England. But if it's just right that the Raiders go to New England next year for a playoff game and beat those damn Patriots, it'll come full circle that what started on a Tuck Rule BS call for a quote-unquote dynasty against the Raiders and John Gruden would be ended by a game where John Gruden coaches the Raiders to a victory over the Patriots like he had 16 friggin' years ago, until the refs came in and gave them the game. Okay, people say, and I'm going to say this quickly, that the Raiders could have done something to stop the drive and stop the field goal and then eventually stop the overtime. Yeah, okay, when you know you won the game and you're disheartened, psychologically you're down, and you're down for the rest of the time. So when you're exhausted, when you know you won something and then somebody takes it away from you, the psychological impact is such that it just kicks you in the ass. So right. Hopefully so. It'll be the Raiders, hopefully next year, to do the stopping of the dynasty, if in fact they do it, hopefully, and God knows I hope, in 2 weeks in a Super Bowl in Minnesota.
And then when the Raiders are there in the championship game to end the dynasty, they will play the Bucs in the Super Bowl.
And the Raiders rematch this time.
And a rematch for the ages, as the Bucs will take home their second Lombardi trophy to Tampa.
I don't think so. If you think that John Gruden is going to lose to a Buccaneers team, nah, not happening there, shipmate.
That'd be a sight to see, though, wouldn't it? Of all the Super Bowl rematches we could get, I gotta say, that would... I mean, probably because I'm a little biased. I'm sure you are as well. But if there were any Super Bowl rematch we could get, that'd be something worth seeing. But we gotta see what happens this next season, and hopefully not, but maybe the season after that as well, regarding the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. But we're gonna get there, man. We're gonna get there. It's been a rough year for you and I both.
Well, it's been rougher for me, I would say, because... Again, we were a playoff team that was supposed to be in the AFC Championship game this year, and somebody forgot to tell the Raiders to stop looking at their press clippings to begin with, and then with all the upheaval on that coaching staff, and you take a fantastic playoff caliber team to a 6-10 moniker, it sucks.
I feel you, man. It's an even further fall from grace. You know, similar situation with the Bucs 2 seasons ago, finished 9-7, this year 5-11. Obviously, we didn't have a playoff run. We weren't next in line for that championship game. But when you do go 9-7 after going 4-12 just 2 years ago, I know how you feel, brother. I feel it 100%. But really quick before we wrap up the show, we got a couple extra minutes. Let's talk about some free agents making some moves here in the offseason. What are you guys, you know, in Oakland's ballpark, what are you guys really looking for in free agency this year? What are the biggest needs?
Well, the biggest thing for the Raiders is obviously we're going to be giving Khalil Mack a huge contract because he deserves it. We locked up Carr last year. It's the Mack contract that will be down the pike. And so that's the first thing that will be done. It's not a free agent move, but it's the first thing that the Raiders will do. Now, having said that, the first free agent move that the Raiders need to make is to lock up Navarro Bowman to a good contract, 2 or 3 years, because again, their defensive coordinator is a linebackers guy, and he knows the value of a stud like Navarro Bowman. Now, granted, Bowman fell into our laps because the Niners cut him, and it was our game. And he is what the Raiders defense needs. You put a stalwart leadership guy that's still not 30 years old back there running your defense. The guy in less than in like 5 days when he was picked up as a free agent was calling plays in his first game playing for the Raiders. That is a professional, and that is somebody that you need on your roster. So the first free agent move that the Raiders need to make after they lock in Khalil Mack is to put Navarro Bowman on a good contract and then go from there. Now, we're pretty much okay on an offensive line that was the last year was the talk of the NFL being the second best offensive line behind Dallas. Both of those offensive lines took hits this year, but we need a left tackle of the future. So that will need to come in the draft. There were some tackles that the Raiders took last year that may or may not pan out, but we'll see. But you definitely will need a left tackle. The Raiders also draft need to get a stud running back, because I don't care if you sign Marshawn, or actually Marshawn is signed, but whether you keep Marshawn Lynch for another year is immaterial. The Raiders need the running back of the future. I would not go into free agency looking for that. I would get them in the very running back rich draft of the 2018 season coming up.
Okay.
Other free agent moves that the Raiders should make is, whether you draft them or not, they need another cornerback to go on the other side of Garyon Conley, who was their rookie that played all of 15 minutes, I think, last year. So they need another cornerback. Their safeties are pretty much set with Obi coming back from injury. He was the second-round pick last year. They got Carl Joseph at the other safety. Reggie Nelson may or may not come back. The one good thing that Nelson has, even though he's lost several steps, is that he knows a Gunther defense, and he's a good leadership guy. Now, there was issues about who were the cancers in the Raiders locker room. I'm not going to name names because it's your guess and my guess, and we can all throw out names. But there was indications that Michael Crabtree may or may not be back. If he's not back, if he was quote-unquote a cancer, then that will need to be addressed. But then again, it's one of those things where Crabtree might have quit on the coaching staff, vice the other way around. So if Crabtree comes back, and I want Crabtree to come back, that's fantastic. If he's an issue, then the Raiders will also need to pick up another wide receiver, I would think, and you can get a decent one in free agency, but we'll see. Either that, you're going to have to draft one again. And, you know, like I said, you always need a plugger in the middle, probably in the draft, a defensive tackle or a rush end, via a kind of like a tween, not a tweener, but like a linebacker slash end to go alongside Khalil Mack if Bruce Irvin doesn't come back. But personally, I want a stud defensive tackle, either somebody like Hurst, Deron Payne. There's several that are coming out of college, so I would draft that and use free agency smartly, get guys of good value, plug in the holes as backups and spot starters as you need, because the Raiders as a core have a really good team. They just need to refine the edges and get some extra players via the draft and free agency, and I think we will be set. And again, I'm not saying this because I'm a Raiders fan. I look at the roster analytically, and I know that this was a team that should have been in the AFC Championship game last year, but has fallen down, and with a car that comes back that is finely tuned. See how I said that? Car finely tuned.
Just for next year. Shop for a little bit.
Yeah. Well, once he comes back and you put all of those pieces with him, you get somebody like Sony Michel in the draft, Nick Chubb maybe, Darius Geis out of LSU. You get a good to go with some good defenders. You re-sign Navarro Bowman. You get that contract to Khalil Mack. You get another corner, either in the draft or in free agency, to go alongside Garyon Conley. And that team is ready to go print up at least a possible invitation to the playoffs, because I never assume a good year, because you can never assume anything because of injury. Right. But you bring that team together with all of those parts that are percolating, getting together under a Gruden leadership, and I tell you, if you're not on the Gru train, your ass is out the door. If you're not working hard, you will be gone. Gruden does not play favorites. As I said, people, when Gruden was coaching the Raiders years back, and he had a punt returner by the name of David Dunn dropped the punt, which allowed the other team to win the game. David Dunn was canned the next day. He was put on waivers. So you know what? If you're not on the Gru train and you are not an asset to the team, you will be gone. So that is a big change in Oakland. It will be the Gru way or the highway. And in that respect, I'm very happy about it.
And taking a look back, coming into free agency and the draft as well, I'll talk about the draft towards the tail end, because I've got, you know, some good faith there, but everything we need this year, only one offensive... obviously we got to work on that O-line, but that's something we'll get to in the draft, and I'll talk about that in a minute, especially if we can't lock down free agency. You're in the market for a running back. The Bucs have confirmed Doug Martin's not going to be back next year, and the worst part about that is Doug Martin couldn't produce here, but I guarantee you he's going to go somewhere else and he's going to put up some numbers. He's not going to be leading rusher, but he's going to be doing some work somewhere else, just like LeGarrette Blount and everybody else who left us a little while ago. All of them already won a Super Bowl. Keeb Tlaib, LeGarrette Blount, Bradley McDermott, DJ Swearinger, one of the best safeties in the NFL. But one of the hardest hitting safeties in the NFL right now. Regardless, let's get back on track about free agency. Bucs need to lock down that pass rush, man. Not a lot of huge guys coming into the free agency picture this offseason. On that front four, Chris Baker was a huge mistake. He needs to turn it around, but I don't know if that's what they're going to be in the market for. But something that is something to think about, and something that was on my mind, if the Bucs were to right some wrongs, Michael Bennett, Aqib Talib, and LeGarrette Blount are all going to be free agents at the end of this season. Now, if the Eagles go to the Super Bowl and win the Super Bowl, I highly doubt LeGarrette Blount's going to be going anywhere. If the Eagles go to the Super Bowl and they lose the Super Bowl and LeGarrette Blount has a great game, I highly doubt he's going to be going anywhere. But just something to think about, especially when you think about the lack of depth the Bucs are going to have in the backfield. We've got three backup running backs cycling that starting position, and these are guys who can't average more than 2-3 yards a game. LeGarrette Blount would be a great fit. I could see him coming back. I know he is getting a little older, but you know what? He's definitely got a lot of great years in him. He's going back to the Super Bowl to face his old team, and he had a career year the year before. Patriots threw him out the door. Eagles picked him up, and he picked up right where he left off. I don't see how Tampa at this point could be a bad fit for him. But, again, that's all about the Bucs righting some wrongs, and that's all about how the Eagles play in the Super Bowl. So that's something we haven't really had the time to focus on. We got to see how this plays out. But looking at the defensive side of the ball, man, something that a name that someone had thrown out there that I really liked was Byron Maxwell, cornerback for the Seattle Seahawks. Obviously, the Bucs are going to need some cornerback help. Brent Grimes, I'm pretty sure he's going to stay another year. His wife had come out and said that he wasn't and that he was going to go somewhere that he knows his worth. But, you know, his wife really does like to run her mouth, and she is an incredible source because not even she knows what goes on in those meetings between the Bucs and Brent Grimes. The guy has age to stay at least one more year. He produced very well next year, so he could come in next year. If you can get him some help with Byron Maxwell and Vernon Hargraves, definitely grooming himself to be a top one-on-one, man-to-man cornerback the way he played this year, I think we'll be all right there. But it is all about snagging somebody in free agency, if not the draft. And the last person I wanted to look at, God, I can't... Oh, I got to Google it. Because I can't remember this guy's name, and I feel bad because I really should know the guy's name. He is a offensive lineman. Plays for the Carolina Panthers. He's going to be going to free agency this year. Do you happen to know who that would be?
The only ones that come to the Khalil brothers, and I don't think it's them. I can't say who you're thinking about, and I apologize for not knowing.
Oh, that's all right, brother. You're good.
Yeah.
Trying to see. I'm trying to see who it is because he plays. I'm Googling it right now, so we're going to get to the bottom of this. But he plays for Carolina, and he's going to be a free agency at the end of this year. And if we can't hold him down, or if we can't end up getting anything going with him this offseason, then we'll talk about the draft in a second. But I really just want to get his name here. And the Panthers are all the way at the bottom of this list, aren't they? Dun, 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 dun. I can't find his name. Oh, well.
There's so a stud from, which would be a plus minus. It would be a plus for the Bucs because you're taking a good guy away from a team in your division. So I got that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Moving ahead towards the draft. Like I said before, I have faith in the draft. Jason Light, whether you agree with him at GM or not, the guy's pretty okay at scoping out talent, as we have seen. He's definitely picked up some great talent in the draft. Not all of them have been great. Obviously, Jeremy McNichols didn't work out this year, but that was because of his lack of effort. And then he went to San Francisco and kind of fell off the face of the planet. Don't even think he started a game for San Francisco. But I think Jason Light can do some good this year. But somebody that we're looking at, first round, and my gut pick for first round, got to go to Bradley Chubb out of NC State. Obviously, if Indianapolis gets to him first, that's going to be a different story. But Bradley Chubb has been a hell of a player this year, and the argument against him, from what I have heard, is that he's mean. But come on now. Come on now. When you've got a mean football player, and this guy isn't, he's not a dick. He's not out here beating women. He's mean on the football field. He's got a swagger about him. Does anybody remember someone named Warren Sapp? Are you kidding?
Oh, I know about Warren Sapp, the guy that took millions of dollars from the Raiders. Yeah, I know about him.
We try to forget when he jumped ship over to the Raiders, his tail end of the career, but
we try to forget that too.
But you know, looking back at a player like Warren Sapp, he was a dick to the media. That doesn't really excuse anything. Bradley Chubb is a young guy. He was. You know, he definitely wasn't the best guy off the field, but he had an attitude on the field. And he had a bad attitude with wanting to win. And that's what we need. You need someone to come in here with attitude. Because if you can get a pass rusher like Bradley Chubb to complement the media angel that is Gerald McCoy. Gerald McCoy is a talented D tackle. When he's not getting double triple teamed the whole game, he can produce. But let's be honest here, man. He's getting older. The guy can do no wrong in the eyes of the media. Which baffles me because he goes off on the fans every other week on social media. But That's another story for another time. But I like the attitude Bradley Chubb brings to the table, and he is definitely a guy you need to be looking at. Now, taking a look at the running back class, because that's obviously something we're going to have to take a handle on this draft as well if we can't get anything going in free agency, because all the top running backs in free agency are going to be as expensive as hell. Le'Veon Bell said he's not going to take the franchise tag with Pittsburgh, so he's going to be wanting a good amount of money. LeGarrette Blount, I'm sure he's going to need a good amount of money after going to the Super Bowl. We probably can't afford those guys. So taking a look at the draft, there's a guy out of Stanford named Bryce Love.
Is coming back for his senior year, so he's off the table.
No way.
Way, way, way.
When was Bryce this?
Bryce Love is not available, shipmate. He is going back for his senior year.
When was at this? Stanford.
He announced that weeks ago.
Oh, I guess I'm out of the loop then.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to distress your listeners.
Oh, no. I had to know at one time or another. But the point I was going to follow up to that, you know, the running back class this year is so deep. I mean, there are so many good running backs, especially when you look at second round, third round talent. None that I can name off the top of my head because I haven't.
Well, I can do that for you. Like I said, the running back class this year, remarkable. You got Penny out of San Diego State, I believe. You got the two out of Georgia. And again, the one that I want, Sony Michel and his shipmate, Nick Chubb, who would be higher if he hadn't had that injury before. You also have, obviously, the class of the draft, Saquon Barkley, but he's going to be gone by pick 5.
I gotta say, man, Saquon Barkley's a hell of an athlete, but I don't know. I see another Jabril Peppers situation with him. You remember how Jabril Peppers, I mean, he's had a great year in Cleveland, but he did go to Cleveland. But he was like a renaissance man in college. He did it all. He played safety, played cornerback. I'm pretty sure they had him in there at running back every once in a while. Linebacker. Jabril Peppers was a renaissance man on the football field, came into the league, and I haven't seen a lot out of him this year. I feel like Saquon Barkley is the same thing.
Nah, I'd kind of disagree there. Now, granted, historically, Penn State running backs don't do well in the NFL. You can go back to John Cappelletti that won the Heisman in the 70s. There was a very high pick whose name escapes me, was either a first, like a number one or number two pick out of Penn State as a running back. Again, historically, Penn State running backs don't do well in the draft. But having said that, Saquon Barkley is a college version of Le'Veon Bell in what he can produce or is projected to produce in the NFL. And the fact that he's shifty, he's got the starts, you know, the stop-go stutter speed.
The vision.
He's going, in my estimation, he's going to be a very, very good running back for whoever picks him up.
Okay. I mean, we'll see what happens. You know, neither of us can really tell at this point. Only time will tell. I hope to believe that he does some great things in the league because he's a hell of an athlete. I just don't want to see the same thing happen to him. I don't want to see him fade into obscurity. You know, Myles Garrett had a hell of a year for Cleveland. Number one.
But didn't hear about it because he was on Cleveland.
Yeah. Yeah, but I mean, you look at Jabril Peppers and the numbers that he put up this year. He was solid, but he just wasn't. I don't know. He's a rookie in the NFL. NFL is different. Maybe I'm looking at it through rose-colored glasses, but I just don't want to see Saquon Barkley go to waste. That's what I'm worried about, and that's why I wouldn't want to pick him up. You know what I mean? I don't think the Bucs would be a great atmosphere for him, because something we talked about a little bit earlier, a couple of episodes ago, I went on a rant about how the Bucs need to build a winning culture. Back to the Raiders, Raiders have a winning culture, the commitment to excellence. Bucs don't have that. We're used to losing. We're used to firing our coach every 2 years. That's why it blew everyone's doors off when we kept Dirk Cutter. So to bring a guy like that into an atmosphere like the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, if you have a loose locker room and a lot of guys who aren't there to win, you're only going to bring in young talent to ruin them. And I think that's something you have to get all your ducks in a row before you start bringing in guys like that. So that's just me talking about how he would fit in with the Bucs scheme. You know, I just don't want to see something bad happen to him, because like you said, he is a great running back, probably the best prospect in the draft right now.
Yeah, Bryce Love's going to be great in next draft, but as stated, the last three Stanford runners-up for the Heisman, Andrew Luck, the kid that plays for the Panthers, what's his name?
Christian McCaffrey.
There you go, McCaffrey, and Love were all Heisman Trophy runners-up from Stanford that all came back for their senior year. So again, you're 0-3 on at least that. If you're looking for a Stanford runners-up from the Heisman, those guys historically have gone back for their senior year.
Yeah, I got you, brother. Maybe we'll be in the market for a running back next year. Hopefully not, but we'll see what happens. The NFL is a crazy place. But ladies and gentlemen, it's been a hell of a ride. It's been a great episode. It's been a pleasure having you here, Captain Jack. But that's just about going to do it for this week's episode of the Cannon Fire Podcast. Remember, you can find us on YouTube and iTunes if you haven't already. Make sure you subscribe on YouTube and leave a 5-star review on iTunes. It means the world to us and costs you nothing. And really quick, before we sign off here, ladies and gentlemen, one more time, Captain Jack, where can the people find you, my man?
Well, right now, be sure to go to J Captain Jack Rackham on Facebook. Eventually, go to Blog Talk Radio, look for Captain Jack's Raider Galleon. That'll most likely be my moniker on Blog Talk Radio. Look for it after the Super Bowl, probably in February, or I might get it started a little bit early, but probably after the Super Bowl. Look for Captain Jack's Raider Galleon on Blog Talk Radio, and I'm actually going to talk to you about how to run YouTube videos, so you're going to help me out there, shipmate.
Oh yeah, no problem, brother. I got nothing but time on my hands right now. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for listening, whether it was on